Praise the Lord. Indeed, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Wherever you find yourself watching this or listening to it, I invite you to consider that sacred space. I invite you to consider it the witness of where God calls us to enter into a time of worship. Let us pray. God, we just thank you for the privilege to worship you in spirit and in truth. Yeah. Allow now your spirit to covet us in ways that we would feel your presence. Yes. And know your power. And rest assured, God, that you are ours and we are yours. Yes. To God be the glory. Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to join the grace in the call to worship. That's that.
The Spirit of God is upon me. God has anointed us to bring good news to the oppressed. We are to bind up the brokenhearted and to proclaim liberty to the captives and release the prisoners. We are to proclaim the year of God's favor and the day of vengeance of our God. We are to comfort all who mourn. For we are called oaks of righteousness, and we displayed the glory of our God. Now our mouth is filled with laughter, and our tongues with shouts of joy.
Thank you.
Good morning. Let us be in an attitude of prayer. Dear Lord, we come to you this morning as humble as we know how, Father God, giving you praise, Lord, and honor, Lord, for all that you've done for us, Lord Jesus. You've given your life so that we may have the right to eternal life, Lord. And we want to say thank you this morning. We thank you, Lord, with our hearts, with our minds, with our souls, dear Lord. I come asking that you just bless, Lord, those that are within the sound of my voice this morning, Father God. Protect and guide them, Lord God, for those that are grieving, Lord. Hold them close for those that are hurting, Father God. Touch them, Lord, for those that are in pain, Lord Jesus. Relieve their hurting, Father God. There's only one that we can call on for all of these problems that we have, Lord, the troubles of the world, Lord. We depend on you. You said in your word, if we would just bring our cares to you, Lord, and place them at your feet, that you would take care of them, Father God. And I'm coming this morning, Lord, a representation of those that are not able to make it to you this morning. Lord, bless them. Keep them, Father God. Dear Lord, I pray that you forgive our sins, Lord. We did the things that you told us not to do. You told us clearly not to do them, but we thought in our human minds that it would be okay. And it turned into disaster, Lord. And we ask that you forgive us. Lord, we ask that you build us up where we're torn down, Father God. Make us stronger where we are weak. For there are some things, weaknesses, it just comes to play in our lives, Lord. And before we know it, we've fallen into that trap. But Lord, we ask that you guard our mouths, bridle our tongues, Father God. Take us into a higher place, Lord, of worship with you today, Father God. Hallelujah. We thank you. We love you. We praise you, Lord. Not for the things that you do for us, not for the things that you've given us, Lord God, but who you are. You are El Shaddai, Lord God. You are Rifa. What is it? Our healer. Yes. Lord, our doctor in the in the hospital, yes. You're a lawyer in the courtroom. And when we do wrong, Lord God, you forgive us, but you also discipline us. And we need to accept that discipline, Lord. And I remember as a child, we used to get spankings for when we did wrong things, and we wouldn't do that again. Lord, please spank us, Lord, to make us remember things, if that's what's needed. Some of us are so hard-headed people, Lord. I'm one of those hard-headed people, Lord. But you saw something good in me, Jesus. You reached down into the pits of hell, and you saved my soul. And today, hallelujah, Jesus, to your precious and your holy name, there is none like you, Lord. There is none like you. And I worship you. I praise you, Lord God. I honor you, Lord, for saving grace. Things that you didn't have to do. But because you loved us so much, Lord Jesus, you saw something better in me. You see things better in others that no one else can see, Lord. And I thank you. Oh, my God, how I praise you. How I love you, Lord. I thank you for this day, Father. And I ask that all who are traveling, Lord God, give them traveling grace and mercy. For those that are sitting at home, Lord, just touch and bless and deal with them throughout the day. Keep us all from hurt, harm, and danger, Lord. And strengthen us, Father, to continue to hear your word and be obedient to your word. In the name of your Son, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Today's scripture comes from John. Chapter 1, verses 6 through 8 and 19 through 28, New Revised Standard Version. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not. Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Elijah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. The promise of the Father is the Spirit without measure. So we ask you tonight to saturate us.
to this Sunday, the second Sunday in December, they tell me it's December the 13th, the third Sunday of Advent. Let us pray. God, we come thanking you for seeing the best in us. And God, because you've seen the best in us, we can hold our head up. We can walk with the assurance that we are yours and you are ours.
Yes, yes.
And God, as we come on this Sunday, the third Sunday of Advent, the second Sunday of December, we ask that your Holy Spirit would fall afresh in each of us. And that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our collective hearts together would be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen, amen, amen. Today, just for a little while, I want us to focus on joy. Now, many of us may think of joy as an emotion that emerges out of us or that is somehow surrounding us by the external factors that we may experience. Some may be reminded of the movie Inside Out, where there's these emotions of joy, of peace, of anger, of frustration. Not that I remember all of them by memory right now, but one of them is joy, and that someone told me that joy was represented by the color yellow. Mm-hmm. And there's something about joy that we want day by day, but every now and then we realize we don't have joy every day. So think about it with me for a little while as we look at John, the first chapter, verses 6 through 8 and 19, et cetera, et cetera. There's something about the Christian witness on this third Sunday of Advent that we think about this message about John the Baptizer. Now, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all tell the story about John the Baptizer, but each gospel talks about it a little different. And I want us to stay in John and see John's version of John's story about the Word of God. I like it in the church when the pastor in the Word, when we say, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." If I say to you, "In the beginning was the Word," and then you respond, "And the Word was with God," that we know we're talking about Jesus. There's something about the witness of knowing God's word.
Amen.
So we come in John thinking about this reflection of John the Baptizer being one that is sent by God.
Amen.
Now, John is very clear who he is. So it helps us look at ourselves kind of like woman in the mirror, child in the mirror, brother in the mirror, sister in the mirror, loved one in the mirror, and say, "Am I clear who I am?" Because John the Baptizer and John the book, the gospel, understood who he was. You see, there's people that was surrounding John, looking at what John was doing, that sent the Levites and the priests to talk to John.
Uh-huh.
You know that, you know how people come and try to check you. You know, sometimes you're at a place and people check you and say, "Who do you think you are? You know, the way you talk, the way you walk, the way you carry yourself. Don't you know you from a certain place?" You know, people are shocked when I say I'm from Compton. And they look at me like, and I was like, "What about that? Don't you understand?" There's something about people's expectation about where we're from. So as the Levites and the Jews were concerned about who John was, they sent a representative, an entourage, if you will, and said, they said, "Miss Blunt, who are you?"
Yeah.
But see, they didn't understand that John had a good sense of who he was. He didn't say that, you know, "I'm Elizabeth's son." He didn't say, "I'm Jesus' cousin." He said, "I am the one calling in the wilderness." See, John understood that he was a witness to what was to come, which was the light that was already among them. See, we have to make sure that when people ask us the question, "Who are we?" are they asking us who our mama and our daddy is? And when I talk to Claretta Foster and Kim Foster, I know that they are home people from Angie, Louisiana. So that we talk a certain way about Uncle Richard and Uncle Camille, and that there's something about the connection that we are as family from the same place. Now, when I talk to my colleagues that are pastors, we talk a certain place, and that they know that I'm at Watts United Methodist Church. They may know that I'm technically appointed to St. John's United Methodist Church, but I want them to understand where my location is so that they understand the ministry that I'm called to be a part of. I could be in a grocery store in a certain neighborhood and people looking, wondering why I'm shopping at that store. Maybe they are looking at what socioeconomic status that I may be from. So when people ask you, Ms. Blunt, who are you? You need to check them and what atmosphere are they asking you, are you from? Are they asking you, are you a tar baby? Are you a Don? Are you a Spartan? There's something about this question that they asked John, who are you? You see, they were waiting for the Messiah. They were waiting for this great entry into Jerusalem that God would send help as in a battlefield. But John reminded them that I'm not the Messiah. I'm not Elijah. I'm not the prophet. I'm just the one sent by God to bear witness to the light. You see, that's why we have extra light during Advent. That we, as people of God, calling ourselves Christians, can experience the reminder of what it means to have hope from First Sunday of Advent. What it means to have peace.
Thank you, Jesus.
The second Sunday of Advent in our series. And this Sunday, joy. Well, when I first looked at this text, I was like, what joy is there in John the Baptizer? What joy is there in people sending an entourage to check you? What joy is there to be reminded about Jesus eventually being baptized by John? What joy is there to put the pieces of the story of who John is together? And then the Spirit of God helped me understand through the witness of the people at Bible study that the joy is that the light is on its way. The light that helps us see in the darkness. The light that helps us understand it's not about where we're from. It's not about our vocation. It's not about what school. It's not about what political party. It's not about what trade we are involved in. It's about our witness of how God has called us for a purpose. And John understood his purpose as being a witness to the one that was among them that was the light. You see, I was driving and I heard on the radio that I was listening to, and that I heard the person on the radio say that people are pessimistic. And I had a concern about that, Ms. Blunt, because in him saying that people were pessimistic, he was saying I was pessimistic. And that I'm conscious that as a Christian witness, that I can't let what the radio personality tells me, what the TV tells me, I have to bear witness to the light. I have to understand that even in a pandemic, even when we're socially isolated, even when the church is empty, so I thank you for being here today, that I can still proclaim the witness of God. You see, because my best part of this book called John is, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God.
Hallelujah.
There's something about the witness. There's something about us understanding as a Christian community, looking back on the birth of Christ, being reminded of John the Baptizer in this text, that John knew who he was.
Is come, let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. Let heaven and nature sing.